is kind of, think of it like a skin tear. The infection is so aggressive in the lungs that, because, you know, it'll stick inside the lungs and it'll grow and consolidate over here. And literally what it's doing is it's starting to tear the lungs. And of course, that's where the bleeding occurs at. So when they cough up blood, TB can do it, lung cancer definitely can do it, pneumonia can do it. And anything that gets into the lungs and can consolidate and grow. TB, of course, fatigue, loss of appetite, weight loss, fever, night sweats, prolonged coughing. And here's your coughing up blood, which is called hemoptysis. Chest pain, shortness of breath, and dyspnea, which is shortness of breath. Guidelines for TB, like I said, it's airborne precautions. Standard precautions, airborne precautions. We're wearing that special PPE and that special N95 mask. That is the main thing that has to be worn, because these paper masks that we wore, see, like I said, they're only going to last you 30 minutes. But if somebody has active TB, you know, those just aren't enough. You've got to wear one of these N95s.
What's the difference N95 and PFR95?
It's just a different brand. When different places make them, it's kind of like copyright stuff. They have to change the name a little bit, or they're infringing on somebody else's copyright.
Oh.
Are those disposable, or do you like wear them all day, or how?
They're not disposable. When I got mine, now I honestly don't know if this is the truth still or not, okay? But because this has been several years ago. But when I got mine, I was basically told, put it in your locker and use it for a month. Now, I never felt, they are expensive. I know that. It does cost a hospital enough.
Well, how does that work? You're taking that infected TB thing, okay, out of that room and over to your locker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I probably need to turn off the tape. I never did it. Even though I was told they're reusable and you can use them, I mean, I never did it once. I never used the same one from one day to the next, just because of what you said. The whole idea of the mask is catching it here on the outside. You know, it catches it. It's going to be here on the outside. It's going to be sitting there. So why do I want to put that by my face again? You know, so nobody ever said anything to me, but maybe nobody ever knew. But, you know, when I was working around it, the box went down pretty fast. Because I refuse to do that. Okay, oxygen therapy. We're going to be going through this in just a bit here. For our people that this consolidation is happening, okay? So, okay, picture somebody here that's got a pneumonia, that's got a TB, that's got influenza. You know, this section of the lung here is all gummed up, okay? So what we do with oxygen therapy is all the rest of this that isn't gummed up, we give it more oxygen. We gotta do something to make up for the part that's blocked off. So what we basically do is give it more oxygen. Okay. Your thermos right there, hold it up a second so everybody sees it, is about 1 liter. So think of that as like when we talk about somebody getting 2 or 3 liters of oxygen, somebody is getting extra, like if they're on 3 liters, they're getting 3 of those full of like 98%, 99% oxygen. Extra 3 of those every minute. So really, when you're talking about 3 liters, that's a lot. course, 4 liters, okay, 4 liters is a gallon of milk, a gallon, okay? So think of that gallon of milk being full of 98% oxygen, and a person on 4 liters is getting one of those every minute. So that kind of gives a picture of, you know, what are these people getting? And they are getting quite a bit of extra supplement.
Well, how many liters is in like a tank like that you got up there by you?
Okay, it's a liter flow. And what's in there is pounds per square inch. But I'm going to turn it on here in just a little bit. But when we talk about liter flow, there's a dial. And so it's kind of like your accelerator in your car. You push it to go faster. You got the gas in your tank. Well, the gas is in these tanks. But as you dial it, it's like pressing down the accelerator more. We can make it go 2 liters, 4 liters, 5 liters, 6 liters. And I'm going to demonstrate here in just a little bit. Because this tank here is not a regular nursing home tank or hospital tank. This is an ambulance tank. And it's because of, you know, Fort Scott has got an EMT program. And that's how we get these bigger tanks. But, you know, they're only used you'll never see something like this in the hospital or the nursing home. And I'll tell you why in just a bit here. But oxygen therapy gives the person basically a supplement. And what we're going to be looking at is like the oxygen cannula and the oxygen mask. We're going to be talking about the guidelines as I pull this stuff out and go through it. We're going to be looking at this thing here, the incentive spirometer. And that basically, the incentive spirometer is the exercise machine for the lungs. Okay, now let me check the minutes here because I forgot to look at my watch again. Okay, 23, so 20. Oops, about 10 till. Okay, now as far as oxygen goes, there are different types of tanks. Okay, most of your portable tanks are going to be about this size. Now, there are also tanks that are huge, like this big around and this tall. Okay, oxygen, like I said, is a gas. It's a very dry gas, so because of that, a lot of times what you're going to see going on is your resident on oxygen is going to be getting humidity. You'll see hooked up to these things a water bottle that is virtually bubbling, okay? Now, think of this as a scuba tank, and this is the regulator, okay? Now what I said earlier about something like this, you are not going to see a regulator. You're going to see a tank like this. But what you won't see is a regulator like this, because this regulator can go up to 25 liters a minute. And like I said, this is virtually on the ambulance, because when they come a gunshot, stabbing wound, car wreck, they're going to need a lot of oxygen. Most of the time, what you're going to be doing in a nursing home is here like this. This is about 2 liters a minute. Now here's what I talked about, stepping on the gas. There's 4 liters. Did you hear it go up? Here's 6. There's 10. That's 25. So virtually, that is really giving out. Now most of the time, 1 to 4 liters is what we're going to be delivering in the nursing home. Now, there is a weird phenomenon called oxygen narcosis. And what that is a person can literally kill themselves by getting too much oxygen. Because a lot of people have the idea if one pill's good, 2 pills are better. And, you know, if 2 pills are good, 4 pills are better. you know, I need to increase my oxygen, and people will fiddle with this. So a person who's on 2 liters, I need some more, they may turn this thing all the way up to 25. Well, what happens is this. If the person has had lung disease for many years, okay, and let's just say around 40 or 45 years old, they started to get emphysema, or they started to get chronic bronchitis, or anything like that. What has happened very slowly, like say they're 40 years old, okay. Now, most of you right now, if I had a pulse oximeter machine, it's like a clothespin. You can put it on your finger. It'll measure the percent of oxygen in your blood. And you don't feel it at all. You know, it's just like a clothespin you put in your finger. You're going to be around 96, 97, 98%, most of you probably. Okay? Well, our friend, when he was in his 40s, before his chronic bronchitis, was probably in the upper 90s. But what happened, because of the lungs were slowly changing, his lungs were changing, so the oxygen amount in his body started to slowly change. Like maybe when he was 43, it was 95% in his blood. When he was a couple years older, it was 93%. Couple more years older, he dropped down to 90, 91. So in his 50s, you know, each year he dropped a percent or half percent. So in his mid-50s, he was basically running about the upper 80s. In his late 50s, he was down to the mid-80s. And it was happening so slow, he never noticed it. It's the same principle of putting a frog in water, in cold water. You put the frog in there, you've heard this, turn up the heat, slowly, frog never notices it, won't jump out, finally will boil to death. But if you put the frog in the boiling water, they're going to jump right out, okay? Well, it's the same thing here with our friend. So it's happening so slowly, he's adapting to it. So he is a little bit short of breath, but like he's our person in their late 50s, early 60s, that goes to the store and buys a couple extra pillows, doesn't know why, doesn't really know what he's doing, but his body, you know, our brain does stuff and compensates for it, and a lot of times we don't even know, you know, why we did this. But he goes, gets a couple pillows, so he sleeps at night with his head up, feels a little bit better. So in his 60s, mid-60s, he's around 85%, but he continues to drop slowly. And then in the 70s, he may be in the lower 80s. And then in, you know, around in the nursing home, he comes in the nursing home, 85, 88 years old, 77, 78%. But he's walking up and down the, not real fast, but he's walking up and down the halls. Now the weather changes, a storm comes in, yeah, he does get short of breath, you know. And maybe if it's a long walk, yeah, he does come back huffing and puffing a little bit. But the whole point is, his body has gone from the upper 90s to the upper 70s, but because it's been so slow, he's accustomed to it. He's adapted. He's fine. Now, any of you in here that go kabam right within the next few seconds, that's the bronchospasm, goes from bam, 99 to 78, you're going to be gasping for breath. But because he went so slow, he's not gasping for breath. So here comes the oxygen narcosis. He comes in, he gets down the oxygen, and he's got a regulator like this. Most of your regulators now, because of this, are going to stop at 4, 5, or 6. But he gets it way up here to 15. Okay, what's going to happen is his brain is going to see all this extra oxygen floating around in the blood, and it's going to say, hey, lungs, take a break. Stop breathing. The person will stop breathing. They're going to be okay for a while, you know, because they've got all this extra oxygen in them, but of course it will deplete as the minutes go by, and they'll start dropping back down, you know. They'll go 95, 90, 85. They'll get back down to the 78s, and sometimes the brain fouls up and forgets to tell the lungs, hey, start breathing again, and the person could die.
So how long do they have to turn it up like that before they will die?
It all depends on them as an individual. How long, what they're used to. If they've been from COPD from a teenager and have been used to like a 78 or a low 70s or high 60s for 50 or 40 years, it'll probably, you know, it won't take very long. You know, they could kick this thing up in a matter of a couple of minutes and have it going, and then of course that process could start.
Now, so did that guy, like if that happened, would he just start breathing, or would you have to resuscitate him?
Well, like I said, it gets back down, and sometimes the brain will tell the lungs, start breathing again. And sometimes it messes up, and they don't. This is where a lot of times, you know, and this is why they don't have these in the home anymore that go these high. Because, you know, you come over to visit him, bring George his supper, and George is in his favorite chair, but he's gone. So what they've done now is they've limited these regulators to only go as high as, like I said, 4, 5, or 6.
Would they ever even need to go as high as that goes?
For the ambulance. Well, and before, see, because what started happening is, you know, when regulators first started to get made, because of the expense of them, they all were made like this. You know, they weren't producing other ones that had limits to them. It's just like the oxygen concentrators. When an oxygen concentrator, we're going to talk about that pretty soon, is a machine that pulls in room air and it concentrates it and puts it out. Well, those concentrators years ago were all made the same way. And they were made with, they could go high, 15, 16 liters. And people were basically doing the same thing. They were using it too high and then not realizing. They would pass out and not some would start breathing again, some wouldn't start breathing again. So when they don't start breathing again, that is the oxygen narcosis. Now, there may be some times when, now, oxygen's a medicine. It's a gas. It's considered now basically a medicine, okay? So most of the time, you know, to put on the regulator, set it up and start it, because it's now considered a medicine, is going to be the CMA or the charge nurse. They may yell for a tank, and they may have you running as quick as you can to get him a tank. Because if somebody is really, really, really short of breath, like I said, we have oxygen concentrators that are these machines, but if they've been off for any period of time, they're cold, they're offline. It takes them about 15 minutes to be plugged in and running to basically start producing the oxygen. So if somebody's really, really, really short of breath, we want to start with a tank. So if you go down to the oxygen storage room, if you see a tank like this, it means it's already been used or it's not full. What you want to look for is one that has a white band around here, like a white piece of paper tape, because that means that tank has not been used yet. That's the tank that basically you want to grab and basically bring back. Now, the regulator here, as I pass this around, you can see here that what it has is like one hole here, and then right here and right here are basically two studs. What those two studs are for is virtually to use to place this thing correctly, because you just got to go up and down until boop, finally it gets in the right alignment. See, it ain't fitting, then all of a sudden, boop, there it does. So those two studs are basically to help you find your spots of where to set the regulator at. Because now a lot of times what will happen is what just did. There's a little green washer here that fits, because this is where the oxygen is going to go into the regulator at, from the tank to here, to go out here, to go to the person. Well, if this little washer is not there, we're going to have not a complete seal, and it could leak air. So basically, you can kind of pass that around. Basically, that's where that washer has to be there, and if it's fallen out, we will not, you know, I'll just spray out the side. You know, it just won't get to the person who needs it. Now that dial has a little pointer, and what that pointer does, when you open up your main valve here, that pointer will tell you how much is left in your tank. Okay, basically a tank like this is only going to last for 2 or 3 hours. You can see right now where that yellow pointer is at. I can't see it. It's on empty. Okay? The washer goes somewhere, did it?
Yeah.
There it is. So you can see they do fall off easily. So if any time it just sprays everywhere when you hook it up, that's why it's not, the washer ain't there. But basically, for the most part, is when you are going to put a tank on, this is your open stem up here, open and closed stem, is where you have to use what's called an oxygen wrench, put it on, and then twist it counterclockwise to basically open it up. And then, of course, you turn it back to the other way to close it off. What happens a lot of time is, I want you looking at that gauge, because a lot of times what can happen to some of our residents is basically this. Like I said, this tank's only going to last 2 or 3 hours. And a lot of times people in the afternoons will be sitting there, they'll have their oxygen cannula in their nose, the tank's been empty for several hours. You know, so we need to keep a watch on those gauges.